Hello everyone and welcome to another video. So here it finally is, here is my ranking of every single TV companion to celebrate me getting to 500 subscribers. But just before we get on with it, I just want to say thank you all to all my subscribers for subscribing and helping me get to this milestone. It really means a lot to me. Also, quick disclaimer, I'm of course only going to be ranking TV companions, so no companions from the various comics, books or audios will be included. I'll do a separate ranking of them some other time. I'll also mostly just be ranking main companions with some exceptions, so most one-off companions will not be included. In addition, I just wanted to say that I apologise if the inclusion of Noel Clarke, John Barrowman and Bruno Langley upsets or causes any discomfort to anyone watching. Whilst I do unfortunately still have to include them due to them still being companions, I do not support or condone their actions or behaviour. The tier list I will be using was created by Dev Levels, so credit to them for it. Anyway, without further ado, let's get on with it. Okay, so we're going to start off with this bottom section here, unsure whether to include them, and that is of course basically just, well, as you can probably guess, I'm not really sure where exactly I put these if I were to count them as fully fledged proper companions. So we have Vastra, Strax and Jenny from the Paternoster Gang. We have Kate Stewart, Osgood from the Modern Unit team, and we have Handles from the Time of the Doctor. So next up we have the unenjoyable category. Okay, so we now come to the unenjoyable category. So yeah, these are just basically like you can probably tell, these are just companions that I just don't really enjoy that much. Obviously this is just my own personal opinion, so if you enjoy any of these companions that I'm about to put on this section, then that is completely fine. But yeah, so we're going to start off with probably a very controversial pick, but like I say, this is just my own opinion, and that is Clara Oswald. Now yeah, I just, like I say, I know it's going to be a bit controversial to put Clara this low, but personally I just don't really, well, I don't enjoy her character at all really. I just don't really find her that particularly like that good or that interesting. It just seems to me like, you know, the writers never really knew what exactly to do with her. When we first meet her in series 7, we've got this whole, you know, impossible girl, Clara Echoes saving the Doctor sort of thing, and her being a nanny to those god-awful, I'm sorry to say, children, Angie and Artie. And then you've got, then somehow she ends up as a teacher in the Day of the Doctor, and then throughout series 8 and 9. I mean, to be fair, I did enjoy her relationship with Danny Pink. I think that was probably like the best kind of use of her character really. I thought that worked reasonably well. But yeah, and then you come to series 9 and then she's all trying to be like the Doctor, and she ends up getting her own TARDIS and companion with the Dinah TARDIS and a Shilda / me. And it's just, it just kind of feels like it's just such radical departures every single series from what they were doing with her beforehand. And I just kind of feel like if they didn't know what exactly to do with her character from the beginning, then why bother to include her for so long? I mean, because she was there for 3 series, one of the longest of any companion. So I just, I don't know, I just don't really enjoy her character that much at all. I don't really think she's that likeable, if I'm being completely honest. But if some of you have her as your favourite, then that's completely fine. Obviously, like I say, it's just a matter of opinion at the end of the day. So next up we have Dodo Chaplet. So yeah, again, I'm sorry, but this is all just my personal opinion, and you know, no offense to the great late Jackie Lane or anything like that, but I just don't think she was, her character was really utilized that well throughout the, well, she had a pretty limited run really of stories that she was in as the companion for. I think she's only in about 5 or so, from The Massacre of St. Bartholomew's Eve, or just The Massacre, all the way to The War Machines, or halfway through The War Machines anyway. And yeah, I just don't find her to be that likeable. She's pretty annoying, pretty irritating. I just don't think that she was utilized or written very well. It's as simple as that, really. No disrespect to Jackie Lane, like I say. And I was very sad when she passed away. I think it was about a year or so ago. But yeah, I just don't think she was really written that well on the show at all. And then finally, we have Chameleon. Another character which, again, just wasn't utilized or written very well at all. I mean, Chameleon, they came up with basically as the next sort of K-9 for the Fifth Doctor era, but then, like, basically he just wasn't used, like, at all, because of the prop being so difficult to work in, everything, because I think it was an actual robot, you know, it wasn't some guy dressed up in a rubber suit or whatever, it was an actual robot that they used. I mean, Chameleon as a character is fine, but like I say, he's just not utilised very well. He gets only 2 appearances, even though he's technically a companion for like half a season. You see him in his first story, The King's Demons, and then you don't see him again until all the way until Planet of Fire, near towards the end of season 21. And that's just, I know it was because of the limitations of the prop and all of this lot, but even so, it just kind of feels a bit of a waste, really, of what could have been quite an interesting companion, you know, a shape-shifting robot. But no, they just didn't really utilise that at all because of constraints that they had with the prop and everything. So yeah, I think that's a terrible, terrible shame, really, because Chameleon had a lot of potential, definitely, but it just didn't happen, unfortunately. I know he was supposed to have appeared in a deleted scene in The Awakening, but yeah, he only gets 2 appearances throughout nearly half a season, which is wonderful. Yeah, not that great at all. So yeah, that is the unenjoyable category. So let's now move on to the next one. So we now come to the meh category. So we're going to start things off with Mickey Smith. Yeah, Mickey's a fine enough character, but he's kind of, again, is one that is at times not utilised or written that massively well. I've got a few problems with his relationship with Rose, but we'll get into that later on when we rank Rose herself. Adam Mitchell, yeah, again, a fine enough character, but not much to really say about him. He's a bit annoying, and yeah, he's, the way he kind of tries to, the stuff he does in The Long Game, where he's, I think, trying to get future knowledge to kind of, for his own ends and everything is a bit, it just doesn't come across as a very good move on his part. So he's not massively likable, but he's not massively unlikable, if that makes any sense. Katarina, I really do want to put Katarina higher, but to be honest, I can't really justify that because she's only in for a few episodes, really. She only comes in at the end of the Mythmakers and then gets killed off. I think it's, is it episode 3 or 4 of the Daleks' Master Plan? One of the two. There's just not much to her character, really. But it is a shame that she wasn't, that she didn't stick around for longer, because, she could have been quite an interesting character. I do quite like the historical companions, and I think it would have been interesting to have had more of her, really. But there's just not much to say about her. I suppose really the potential for the kind of for the first Doctor to be teaching her all about like stuff that she wouldn't know about coming from ancient Troy and everything is kind of the relationship that we would end up later getting on with the second Doctor and Jamie. And to be fair, I think it works a lot better with the second Doctor and Jamie than I think it ever could have done with the first Doctor and Katarina. But regardless, Katarina's fine. And I really did enjoy the Big Finish audio that they did a few years ago, called Daughter of the Gods, all about what if Katarina hadn't have died, I think it was, and sort of if like the first Doctor Stephen and Katarina had been diverted from the planet Kembal to a different planet because of their TARDIS crashing into the second Doctor's TARDIS. Really good story, really good audio. But yeah, there's not much else for me to say about Katarina, really. Mel, Melanie Bush. Again, she's a fine enough character, but well, again, as I keep saying for a lot of these, she's just not utilised or written very well. She comes in towards the end of the Trial of the Time Lords and Colin Baker's television era, anyway. And she's fine, but there's not really that much to her character, really. I mean, she was supposed to be a computer programmer, I think, was the original kind of like brief for her character or something, but that never gets actually used or like actually mentioned very much at all. That is a terrible, terrible shame, really. Real waste of her character in many ways, because I think she definitely had potential, like Chameleon, to be a really good companion, I think, certainly. And then Susan, well, again, like Katarina, I want to put her a bit higher, but she's just another one that is just not written very well and doesn't get that much to do really during her time as a companion. I mean, the most she gets to do really is Ascensi Rites, where she will learn about her telepathic abilities and everything, and that's really good. I like that a lot. But yeah, she doesn't really do anything else. She's just the archetypal classic series female Doctor Who companion, basically. She is the one that screams a lot and asks a load of questions, and that's basically it. I mean, yeah, sure, there are other classic female companions on this tier list and everything, but I think a lot of them get utilised a lot better than Susan because at least they have more of a chance to do something else and come across as kind of more likable characters. Susan, I really do want to like her, but sometimes, her constant screaming and everything, it's just annoying. It's just really irritating. It's a real shame because, with her being the Doctor's granddaughter and basically a Time Lord or Gallifreyan herself, There's definitely a lot of stuff they could have done with her character, and the Sensuites, as I said earlier, is a real good example of what they could have done with Susan. But that's just never utilized in any of the other stories at all, which is a real terrible shame because, like I say, I really want to put Susan higher, but I just can't justify it ultimately because she just wasn't written that well enough, really. I mean, she was Caroline Ford, who played her, was that unhappy with the way that Susan was written that she ended up leaving the show because of it. Which is a shame, but it just goes to show how not even the actor or actress playing her was very happy with the way Susan was being treated by the writers and everything. So, yeah, it is a real shame, absolutely. But I think Big Finish has done a pretty good job with kind of rectifying all of that a bit. I'm not that familiar with every single audio that Susan has been in, but so I've not listened to all of them yet. But the ones I have listened to, she does feel, it does feel like she's getting a bit more to do, really. But it's a shame that she never got to do more in the television show itself. So next we come on to the next category, which is serviceable. Okay, so we now come to the next category, which is of course the serviceable category. So we're going to start things off with Rose Tyler. Now again, I think this is going to be a very, very controversial pick, but I just, as I alluded to earlier, I just do not. I have massive issues with Rose's relationship with Mickey. I think that she's way too nasty and horrible and toxic towards him, and to be quite honest with you, a lot of time I do not see why Mickey would still want to be with her. But you know, and then the whole 10 Rose thing later on, and how she continues to just be so horrible towards Mickey and everything, and just to show off towards the 10th Doctor and flirt with him and everything. Yeah, I just don't like it at all. Yeah, I really don't like how, but I think it's the Series 2 Cybermen two-parter, that's the Rise of Cybermen and the Age of Steel. Mickey's kind of a bit fed up of just being kind of constantly just third wheeling between the 10th Doctor and Rose, and yeah, you can really tell just how fed up he is, and I completely understand why. You know, it's just not, I, like I say, I do not understand why he'd still want to be with Rose. Yeah, it's just, yeah, but then again, having said that, you know, she does work quite well with the Ninth Doctor, for most part, and even some bits with her and the Tenth Doctor when they're not being that insufferable, and irritating together. You know, it can be quite good. I know that for those of you who've watched some of my previous videos will know that I'm a massive Tenth Doctor fan, but yeah, I'm not. That does not necessarily mean that I'm a fan of Ten and Rose, because I'm definitely not, as you can probably clearly tell. And then everything that I've just said for Rose basically would apply for Amy Pond as well. I think that her relationship with Rory again is just so toxic, and I do not understand why Rory would want to be with her. But the difference between her and Rose is at least Amy, as far as I can remember anyway, I could be wrong here, but I believe Amy at least gets challenged and, you know, kind of by people about it later on, whereas Rose I don't think ever really does. So that's kind of one thing which kind of redeems it, or, well, doesn't necessarily redeem it, but you know, it's kind of, you know, at least she ends up kind of realizing the error of her ways, as it were, and kind of making up for it a little bit later on, even though she's still kind of taking a mick out of Rory a lot, and yeah, being a bit toxic and everything, and still showing off to the 11th Doctor and all this lot. But yeah, at least she kind of she kind of progresses into treating Rory a bit better later on, certainly. And then Rory, we have next Rory Williams himself. There's just not that much to say that I haven't already said, basically, when I was talking about Amy just then. It's just their relationship together is just toxic. That's the best word I can think of to describe it, really. It's just toxic. And I know I keep saying this for a lot of companions on this ranking, but it is very true for quite a few of them that a lot of them just aren't utilized or written very well at all, basically, and Rory is a very good example of that. And then Adric is a good enough character, certainly. I mean, I do enjoy his interactions with the Fourth Doctor when it's just the two of them, for the Keeper of Traken, and at least the first bit or first half of Logopolis. I enjoy them two together. I think that's a really good TARDIS team or Doctor and Companion pairing. But then when you get into the Fifth Doctor era, he's just very insufferable and is constantly arguing with the Fifth Doctor over silly and ridiculous and stupid stuff, basically. It just really drags Adric's character down, basically, and that's it for Adric, basically. That's all I can really say. And then for Ryan Sinclair, I really do want to put Ryan a lot higher, but I just, again, I can't really justify it because it's just, he's never really given that much to work with, really. I mean, with Series 11, you've got at least a thing going on with between Ryan and Graham, where Ryan gradually accepts Graham as his granddad, and then also the two of them trying to get over Grace's death and everything, and that's really good and that's really well done and everything. But then Series 12, Ryan is basically a spare part, for the most part. There's just not that much that's really done for his character, really. I mean, it's a real shame because I think, again, he's a companion who had a lot of potential, but it just didn't come together for whatever reason. And then lastly, we have River Song. Now, again, this is going to be a very controversial pick, I'm sure. Well, I mean, it's not to say River Song is a bad character. She can be definitely a good character, but Series 6, I do not like that much at all. And seeing as that is basically the River Song series, out of all of them, after all the ones that she's in, because that is the one that focuses most on her background and all this lot. It's just, it's a lot of it is just being overcomplicated and convoluted for the sake of it. River Song is kind of, to be honest, I'm not a massive fan of the Stephen Moffat era. And River Song kind of is a lot of Stephen Moffat's female companions kind of come across, sorry, as being very unlikable, very full of themselves. And River Song can be a pretty good example of that. I think Clara is probably the worst for it. And I will be doing later on, at some point, a whole video essay about why exactly I do not like Clara, even though I kind of alluded to a lot of it earlier. But River Song, I just, it's she's fine with the 10th Doctor, in Series 4 with the Silence of the Library and the Forest of the Dead two-parter, and then she's pretty good for the most part in the Husbands of River Song with the 12th Doctor, although that episode itself is pretty bland and forgettable, really, for the most part, apart from the ending, which is really well done, really well written, just so emotional and everything. But yeah, just yeah, with the songs, just it's I do want to put a perhaps a bit higher, but I just again just can't really justify it because yeah, I just it's just really difficult for me to completely like River Song as a character because she's definitely got good things going for her as a character, as a companion. But it's just yeah, for every good thing there is a bad thing about her, if that makes any sense. So yeah, that is the serviceable category or section done. So now we're on to the next one, which is enjoyable. Okay, so for this next section, the enjoyable category, I'm mostly just going to do a time lapse, really, just because of just how many companions we've got left, and because there's going to be a lot in this section. So yeah, apologies for that. If there's any that I do want to talk about, then I may talk about them, but I think most of the ones that I want to talk about will probably be in the fantastic category, which will be after this one. So yeah, without further ado, here is the enjoyable category. Okay, so I'm just going to quickly talk about some of the ones from the enjoyable category that I wanted to talk about. And that is... so we're going to start off with Yaz. So yeah, Yaz is one that... if I'm being completely honest with you, a year or so ago, I'm not sure if I necessarily would have put this high. But I do kind of feel like... as we've gone on, her character has gotten a lot better, a lot more developed for the most part. I feel like there's still ways in which they could improve and develop her character more, but yeah, I'm quite, you know, as much as I'm not normally a fan of Doctor and Companion romances, I didn't really mind the 13th Doctor and Yaz stuff in Eve of the Daleks, because I thought that was really well handled, and I don't mind if well, I'm presuming that they'll probably continue it in Legends of the Sea Devils and the Centenary Special as well. So yeah, I'm very much looking forward to seeing how that turns out. I just hope it's not... I have a feeling it's probably going to end on quite a sad note with the 13th Doctor leaving Nevfin and regenerating, but I hope it's not too sad, and I hope it's not where, you know, Yaz dies or whatever. I hope it's something a bit more kind of... with this being, I think, the first same-sex relationship between a Doctor and a Companion. And the first kind of main same-sex relationship apart from Vastra and Jenny that I can really think of. Yeah, I'm really hoping that they don't just make it have a really, really sad ending, because I feel like that would kind of undermine the importance of the 13th Doctor and Yaz's relationship. But yeah, Yaz overall as a character, in series 11 she wasn't really given that much to do apart from Demons of the Punjab, which was a pretty good episode for Yaz actually, although it wasn't quite as good as something like Rosa, for example, but you know, it was still pretty good for the most part, and it at least gave Yaz something to do, and it developed her character a bit more. But yeah, for the rest of series 11, she wasn't really given much to do. And in series 12, for the most part, she wasn't given much to do either, apart from Can You Hear Me with the whole mental health thing, with the police officer, and I think it was a Penny or something. Yeah, that was quite good, but again, didn't. F it still felt a bit. It still felt like Yaz was a bit underdeveloped, really. And then, yeah, I think with Doctor Who Flux or series 13. Yaz has gradually started to feel more of a well-established and developed character. She started to kind of, in a way, do a similar thing to what Clara was doing with becoming a bit like the Doctor, but unlike Clara, it's not as irritating or as insufferable, in my personal opinion, because. You know, she's not using it as an excuse to be arrogant and a big arrogant know-it-all or anything like that. She's just. I think it's kind of. With Yaz, you get the sense that she's using it, not just because of her love for the Doctor, but also because she's finding a new found confidence in herself, in a way, I suppose. And it's kind of becoming more confident in herself and. You know, kind of. Because she's travelled with the Doctor for so long now, she's kind of started to feel comfortable, like, and started trying to be in control of the situation, or at least knowing what to do if anything goes wrong and stuff like that. And, you know, I think that's a much better way of doing it, really, personally, anyway. But that's just my opinion. Now, as for Grace Holloway, I know it's a bit kind of strange to put her this high up because. She's only really kind of technically a one-off companion, but I've included her this high up because, to be honest, I do really enjoy her relationship with the Eighth Doctor in the TV movie. And I do actually think it was a crying shame that, you know, Grace never became, didn't just accept the Eighth Doctor's offer to travel with him and everything. I think that's a real shame, but, you know, I can understand her reasons why. Yeah, it's yeah, I don't really have much else to say really. I do actually quite like the TV movie. The TV movie. I know a lot of people don't necessarily like it that much, and I can understand why. It's definitely got its issues, but I don't think it's that bad really. I think it's pretty good for the most part actually, and I think the Eighth Doctor and Grace's relationship with each other is definitely one of the strongest parts of that. Of the TV movie, and really, really sells the whole story to me. Yeah, I just really enjoy Grace as a character, even though she's, I suppose, technically a one-off, but yeah, whatever. Yeah, so then Harry Sullivan. Again, I wanted to put Harry a bit higher, but it's just. I do enjoy his interactions with the Fourth Doctor and Sarah Jane, but I just don't feel like Harry is really in it for that long because I know the idea, the character of Harry Sullivan was created in case the Fourth Doctor turned out to be another older man who wasn't really able to take care of the kind of physical, kind of action hero kind of. Stuff, so then they came up with Harry to be that instead. But with the Fourth Doctor being at the time anyway, one of the younger Doctors, who and you know, Tom Baker was able to do the physicalities of it and do all the stunts and everything, or most of them, yeah, it just feels like Harry's not really utilized quite as well as he could have been, and. It's a real shame that he leaves as suddenly as he does because, you know, I think the Fourth Doctor, Sarah Jane, and Harry are really, really good TARDIS team together, and I really enjoy season 12 because of that. But yeah, it's just a real shame that Harry just didn't stick around longer and wasn't developed a bit more, basically. And Sarah Kingdom. It might be a bit kind of strange again to put her this high up because she is also like Grace, a bit of a one-off companion. because she's only really in for the for most of the Daleks' master plan. But I really do enjoy Sarah Kingdom, and I really enjoy her interactions with the First Doctor and Steven. I'm not too sure why, it's just, for me, again, like with the Fourth Doctor, Sarah Jane and Harry, it just seems like a really good TARDIS team, basically. So, yeah, that's it for Sarah Kingdom. K-9, a really iconic companion and character. I really, really enjoy all of the K-9s. I'm not going to put them separately or anything, because they're basically the same character. But yeah, just I just really enjoy K-9 interacting with the Fourth Doctor and both Romanas and later Adric as well. Yeah, and then later on, him appearing with Sarah Jane Smith in K-9 and Company, and then later Sarah Jane Adventures, and then him even getting his own spin-off himself, K-9, the British-Australian TV show K-9. He's a really iconic character, and I completely get why. And yeah, I just can't help but love K-9 so much, really, basically. So yeah, I think that's pretty much all of the ones for the enjoyable category that I wanted to talk about. So we'll now finally get on with the final category at the very top, the fantastic category. So here it is. Okay, so as much as I've just said that the fantastic category would be the last category that we're going to be talking about, it's actually not going to be now, because I was just realized once I'd recorded that bit that actually I kind of wanted to put my absolute favorites in a different section. So the very top section now is one called Top 10, and then this one that we're now going to come to, the fantastic section, is just below that. So yeah, I think I'm probably going to do another time lapse for this bit. So yeah, again, apologies for that. But here is the fantastic section. Okay, so we finally come to the actual proper final or top section this time, and that is my top 10. So a lot of what I have to say really for these is basically just the same stuff again and again, so I would be repeating myself an awful lot, just saying how great and amazing I think they are. So yeah, we've got so we'll start off at 10th place. We have Wilfred Mott. Yeah, I know he's a bit of a one-off companion technically speaking, but I just love his interaction with the 10th Doctor so much in The End of Time. And yeah, I would really have loved to have seen more of them together as a proper fully fledged TARDIS team. And then we've got Ian and Barbara in 8th and 9th place, respectively. Yeah, these are part of the OG or original TARDIS team, and yeah, it's such a good TARDIS team for the most part. I know I did say, like, Susan gets a bit let down with the writers, like, earlier, but Ian and Barbara are really good, strong companions, and I really love the four of them together. well, the three of them together with the First Doctor, of course. And yeah, they're just such a great and iconic TARDIS team. And Ian and Barbara are just such wonderful characters, really. Then in seventh place, we've got Zoe Herriot. Again, just one that I really, really enjoy. And I just, yeah, I really love the Second Doctor, Jamie and Zoe, as a TARDIS team. And one of my all-time favourite teams, for certain. I really love that era of the Second Doctor's time, especially like the late, you know, later on, towards the end of his era with Season 6. And a bit of Season 5 with the Wheel in Space. Yeah, it's just that team was one of the first classic series TARDIS teams that I ever watched, because some of the first classic stories that I ever watched were the Mind Robber and the Invasion, as well as I think the Seas of Death, or Seas of Death might have been a bit later on. But yeah, definitely at least the Mind Robber and the Invasion, and yeah, just got such fun and such great nostalgic memories of watching Second Doctor, Jamie and Zoe together. And yeah, I just think they really work well together. Zoe is still a bit of the archetypal classic series female companion, with the order screaming and running about and asking questions and everything. But also she's a bit more, she's a bit of a stronger character, a bit like Barbara really, because, you know, she's kind of the Doctor's intellectual equal, really, when it comes to a lot of things. Zoe is, yeah, a real step forward, I think, into having way more strong minded female companions. And then in sixth place, sorry, I just need to check what stage we're at then, we've got Martha Jones. And yeah, again, such great nostalgic memories of Series 3. I really enjoyed the 10th Doctor and Martha together. The only thing I kind of take issue with is the 10th Doctor's treatment of Martha, just because basically she wasn't Rose, and I really do not like that side of the 10th Doctor at all, and that really, really irks me, to be honest. So, but yeah, it's still really good Doctor and companion pairing. And yeah, Martha, I really commend her for, at the end of Series 3, for kind of just having it all out with the Doctor, really, but in a kind of nice and non-confrontational way, if that makes sense. Kind of just kind of telling him how it is, but in a nice way. And finally admitting her feelings for him and everything. Yeah, I think that's really, really great stuff. And then number five, we have Donna Noble. Again, nostalgia, mostly. Series 4 is one of the greatest series or seasons or whatever of Doctor Who of all time, as far as I'm concerned. And the 10th Doctor and Donna, one of the greatest Doctor and companion pairings, absolutely. Just so much fun I have with, just even if I were just to watch the odd episode with them two in it, I just have such fun watching the two of them together. And I really love how, you know, we get away from the whole romantic side of things with Donna. You know, we go from the 10 Rose nonsense and everything, to the really tragic 10 and Martha stuff, and then we get onto 10 and Donna, which, yeah, they're just best mates. They're just really great friends, and I just love that. I just love that in any Doctor and companion team. I really love it when, you know, there's no romantic subplot between either of them. You know, don't get me wrong, that can work. I think like I said earlier, for Yaz, I think that works well for the 13th Doctor and Yaz. But yeah, for the most part, I do think that romantic relationships between the Doctor and their companions don't tend to work that well. And they don't necessarily need to really be there. And I think Donna, the 10th Doctor and Donna, is a really good example of why they don't need to be there, because the Doctor could still be best friends with their companions and get on really, really well with them. In fourth place, we have the Brigadier, because yeah, I just really love his character. I love his interactions with pretty much every single Doctor that he ever interacted with, really. I think there's definitely something great and magical and really unique about his interactions with the Third Doctor, who he spent most of his time on show with, because the Brigadier was, of course, a real mainstay of the Third Doctor era of the UNIT family, and I love the UNIT family overall, with the Brigadier and Benton and Yates and Joe Grant and Sarah Jane Smith and even Liz Shaw and everything. Just wonderful, wonderful stuff, really. Yeah, the Brigadier is just one of those characters that just works so well with every single Doctor that he meets. He works well with the Second Doctor, he works especially well with the Third Doctor, who works really well with the fourth, fifth, sixth, if you count dimensions in time, with the Seventh Doctor, and yeah, and then later on with the Big Finish audios, where he gets to meet the Sixth Doctor again and meets the Eighth Doctor, and then I think now he's met the Ninth Doctor with John Coulshaw playing the Brigadier. It was a real shame when Nicholas Courtney died, actually, about 11 years ago it was now. I was really, really upset about that, because the Brigadier is such an iconic Doctor Who character, and for really, really good reasons, basically. In third place, we have Ace. Again, such an iconic and wonderful character. Basically, the template for most of the New Who companions, New Who female companions. Yeah, everything about Ace is just so wonderful. Her interactions with Seventh Doctor, again, is such a brilliant TARDIS team. Yeah, there's not much else I can really say about Ace that I haven't already said for the others on in this top 10, but yeah, Ace is wonderfully iconic and memorable character. And again, for really very, very good reason. In second place, we have Sarah Jane Smith. Of course, it had to be Sarah Jane. Yeah, I don't really. The thing is I've never heard anyone say anything really bad about Sarah Jane Smith. I think she's one of those companions that I think at least most Doctor Who fans really, really love. Like her interaction with the Fourth Doctor, especially. They are such, again, such an iconic duo together. Just really great pairing. Stuff of the Third Doctor is not quite as good, but it's still, pretty good for most part. But yeah, again, like with the 10th Doctor and Donna, the Fourth Doctor and Sarah Jane were just really were the best of friends, basically. And I, again, like I said earlier, I always loved that in a Doctor and Companion pairing. And yeah, the Fourth Doctor and Sarah Jane is just another example of why it works so well, I think. And then later on, her coming back with the 10th Doctor, and then getting her own spin-off with the Sarah Jane Adventures, and then meeting the 10th Doctor again, then the 11th Doctor. Yeah, it's I completely understand why she got her own spin-off, because she absolutely deserved it, and the Sarah Jane Adventures was such a massive part of my childhood. One of the things that helped me to get into the classic series of Doctor Who. So it was a real terrible shame when Elizabeth Sladen, who played her, sadly passed away, also 11 years ago now. Yeah, Sarah Jane just continues to be one of my all-time favourite companions, and an all-time favourite companion for, I think, most Doctor Who fans, basically. And for, again, as I keep saying, for very, very good reason. So my number one pick right now would have to be Jamie McCrimmon. Now, to be fair, you know, these, I think, like, the top five can be pretty interchangeable, and especially the top two can be pretty interchangeable. But right now, I would say Jamie's probably my favourite companion. I recently rewatched The Tomb of the Cybermen, and yeah, I just was reminded of just how good the Second Doctor and Jamie are together as a real, as a really good, like, comedic, but also really good Doctor and companion pairing. They're just, again, so iconic, so memorable. And yeah, Jamie is just a really fun and great companion, and the perfect companion for a Doctor like the Second Doctor. I mean, I would love to see Jamie come back to show at some point, but I can't imagine it would be quite as good working with a different Doctor as it was with the Second Doctor, if you see what I mean. I think, like, the Second Doctor and Jamie, you know, Jamie works the absolute best with the Second Doctor. His interactions with the Sixth Doctor and the Two Doctors are pretty good. I don't think he's... I think his interactions with the Sixth Doctor, are nowhere near as good as the ones he has with the Second Doctor, but still pretty good. And yeah, I wouldn't have been completely against it, actually, if Jamie had joined the Sixth Doctor and Perry, to be honest. I'm kind of glad he didn't, because, like I say, I think he works best with the Second Doctor. But yeah, he's just a really, really good character. So yeah, that is it. That is my Doctor Who TV companion ranking every single TV companion from 1963 to the present, from all the way from Susan to Dan. Anyway, so there's my ranking of every single TV companion. But how would you rank them all? Did you agree with my ranking or not? Please let me know in the comments section below. Anyway, so thanks for watching, hope you liked it. Please don't forget to press that subscribe button below, as well as press the bell icon at the side of it, so be notified of when all my new videos come out. Also, please rate and comment below what your ranking would be. So, until next time, bye-bye!